Mr. Moderator, Your Excellencies, distinguished delegates, ladies and gentlemen, just like many, I had never thought of any opportunity in this world that would happen to me that would have those green stones behind me. I have watched it on television. I'd never thought I would stand right in front of them. Even the huge logo in front of me, I've watched it on television. I'd never thought I would stand behind it. But today is the day that the Lord has chosen, and I'll celebrate it with all of you. We have not inherited this world from our forefathers. We have borrowed it from the future generations. That has been said about our role to protect the environment and so many other things. As young people, as young leaders, that should be our focus. This is the second time I'm addressing this theme to young leaders of the world. Moral and innovative leadership for sustainable development, vision, service, and entrepreneurship. This theme is essential about our shared future and our shared responsibility towards it. So why are we here again? First, it's because we are not done. I just hope we have started the mission, our mission to make the world a better place. I hope we have started it. Second, moral leadership, in the sense that we live in a state of moral disengagement, where we have justification for doing all the wrong things, yet we know better. It is okay, because everybody is doing it, so it's fine. It is okay, because the orders were from superior authorities. It's wrong, but it's okay, because the orders were from superior authorities. It is okay, because it was for a bigger purpose. It's wrong, but it's okay. Moral disengagement is a situation where we live now. The solution is in moral leadership. Third, innovative leadership, making the case that we can no longer do business as usual. What we need is not what we already know. Rather, we should employ exploratory thinking, which is all about innovation, creativity, and unconventional thinking. Aristotle one time said that we learn from history, that we learn nothing from history. The solution is innovative leadership. And fourth, our world is one. Our problems are similar, and the body of waters that separate us is not deeper than the blood that connects us here as human beings, one people under God. We must therefore work together to find appropriate solutions. This assembly reminds me of the day I was introduced to jazz. Jazz music has a complex expression of the deep-seated feelings, exploring both anxieties and potentialities, going through the unknown, but together, each instrument playing a different but complementary role to produce a symphony and a rhythm of success. This assembly is like jazz music. This is our story today. What we're experiencing here is electrified by the anxiety and excitement of discovery, of us fumbling and fretting and figuring out each potential and essential character of our vision as we go along. We are literally walking on a road we are building. So let us not miss the significance of this moment. This is a great opportunity for young leaders of the world. And as the evangelist Leonardo Ravenhill said, an opportunity of a lifetime must be seized within the lifetime of that opportunity. We are here to do just that. Seize this opportunity, this very moment, and move from rhetoric to action. We do this by providing a forum for connecting people and engaging in purposeful dialogue about our shared future. By emphasizing that vision, entrepreneurship, and service are the foundations of effective leadership, learning important lessons, skills, and collaborating on strategies for sustainable peace and development, and also insisting that moral leadership is, remains, and must remain true like the magnetic north, unchanging and unwavering, directing our thoughts, words, and action. The overall purpose of this is building an integrated, equitable, sustainable partnership among young leaders and young professionals for all around the globe for sustainable peace and development. This will facilitate the purposive unity, the mutualism, and the unbounded potentialities we have for collaboration in the promotion of world peace. There's an African saying that if you want to travel fast, travel alone. But if you want to travel far, travel with others. Our shared future is a journey we can only travel together. We will not accomplish this journey in one day or even one year, but together our resolve is stronger than our challenges. Together, we will bring our collective wisdom to bear on our challenges and bring those challenges within our means of meeting them. In this journey, we will not be tied by the clock, nor by days, nor by weeks or months, but our purpose. We must not travel in vain. Does that mean my time is up?
Yes.
I hear something ringing here. As George Harrison sang in his song, Any Road, he said, if you do not know where you are going, any road will take you there. That means we must not only agree on where we are going, but we must also agree on the route that will take us there. A plan without action is a dream, and an action without a plan is a gamble. We cannot gamble our future. In the last assembly, you met and engaged in deep conversation, a conversation about our shared future, to try and recapitulate a shared vision. We have to face it. The very choice of this theme is proof, if any proof was required, that somewhere along the line, we as God's children defaulted our core law, loving our neighbor as ourselves, resulting in insurgencies, insurrections, and wars. Wars which are extremely different from the ones before that came and led the world to agree on the never again declaration in the UN Charter and the conventions of Geneva. The non-conventional wars where the last person you want to be is a woman or a child. We posed questions when we met. We set goals. We outlined both our challenges and our opportunities. We have identified the resources available to us to make good. Today we come to Washington, D.C., to Philadelphia, and to New York to essentially take stock of our past activities and to boldly declare that our shared future is our shared responsibility and is the rhythm of our success. And in this, nobody wins until we do. Our history is taking too many turns. As young leaders, we have a significant role to play. Like somebody said, we should not mind what turn history takes, but we must not allow history to take any turn without our participation. So there are three things as young leaders we must do to live up to this collective responsibility. One, participate. Two, participate. And three, participate.
Thank you. Thank you.
However, your participation must never be in vain and must never draw negative energy. Rather, it must help build a better world for us and our posterity. So we must work to support the resolve of our civilization to preserve, perfect, and perpetuate progress for us and our posterity, our shared future. Today's challenges are many, and we must not forget the sheer urgency of this moment. For we meet at a time when the world is facing challenges and tensions brewing everywhere, threatening world peace. A world economic crisis, climatic change threatening the very existence of the world, political instability, time up. That is part of the political instability. There's never enough time to discuss important matters. Because if I had known I was going to be timed by the clock. I wouldn't have flown all the way to come and speak for 3 minutes. Really, I don't think it is fair. I prepared, I traveled for 36 hours to come and speak for 3 minutes. It doesn't make sense. But as a law-abiding citizen of the world, let me close this way. The world is in search of hope. We are that hope. And we must behave like we are that hope. The realization of this hope lies in us setting clear and focused goals, working together to shape our future. The future is already here, and we should use this opportunity to prepare a blueprint for sharing it. What we think, how we think, what choices we make, what we invest in, how we create relationships, and all those things must be within this. The world is changing, and we must change with it. Madam, I'd like you to allow me just tell the story, and I close. And my story is a simple one. It will actually summarize my story on hope. A little boy lit 4 candles. And the candles were burning brightly and darkness was chased. After a short while, a little wind blew and the first candle went out. The first candle, the boy had called it peace. When the candle of peace went out, there was trouble. Then the second candle said, in the absence of peace, I cannot survive. It also went out. That second candle, the boy had called it love. When the candle of love is out, the world is in trouble. The third candle say, no, there's no need living now. It also went out. That candle, the boy had called it faith. Faith in whatever we believe in, we lose faith in it when the candle of faith goes off. The boy went back into the room and found 3 candles not burning. And he said, I lit you to light the world. Started crying. Then the fourth candle said, young man, when I am still burning, you can pick me, light the rest. Light faith, light love, and light peace. For I am hope. So the boy picked the candle of hope and lit faith, lit love, and lit peace. We are the candle of hope as young leaders. Let's pick what is left and light the world, give it hope. My story and your story is a story of hope. God bless you all. Thank you.